You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope and you restore every heart that is broken. Sing it to him. Great are you, Lord, 'cause it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out praise to you only. You give life, sing it. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour.
Good morning, everybody. Go ahead and stand to your feet. Hey, Dan, can you shut the door back there? Well, we are tired and excited at the same time. These guys have worked so hard getting this place ready for Vacation Bible School. Jesse and her team, and Ann and Gary, and just everyone that helped with the decorating the place. Give them a big God bless you. We've got a song that we're going to do right before the offering to get everybody jacked up and ready for Bible school. And anyway, would you bow your heads with me, and we're going to worship the Lord, and we're going to prepare this place today, not only for Vacation Bible School, but how many of you want a move of God this morning? Let me see your hands. God shows up, and things are going to change this morning, guaranteed. Virgil Phillips, come up here. Pray for us.
Well, praise the Lord. Father, we come before you today in the name of your Son, Jesus. Lord, we pray that you would come down and kiss the frontline church of God and let the congregation get caught in the smack. We need your anointing of the Holy Ghost here today. Lord, there's needs in here today, and your word declares that you supply our needs according to your riches and glory. And glory is rich today. Let it be rich in the congregation today, knowing our pastor as he brings forth the word, not the singers. Lord, let the anointing come that breaks every yoke of bondage. We've come to worship you. Help our hearts to praise you and our lips to sing out to your glory. In Jesus' name.
All right, put your hands together. Welcome the Lord into this place.
Oh, He called us out of the grave into his marvelous light. Well, this week starts off Vacation Bible School. And there's just going to be a lot of young people that are going to come into this church that have probably never heard of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And Chris had Virgil come up and pray this morning. For those of you that have never heard his testimony, he shared with the youth a couple weeks ago. And he was talking about miracles and some of the miracles that he's seen, just praying for people with cancer and cancer disappearing. Even was talking about praying for somebody that the doctors had pronounced dead that came back to life. But the most amazing thing that Virgil shared with us is he said, I've seen all of these miracles, but the greatest miracle was that he took a young man that's dad was an alcoholic that was far away from God, and he brought him into salvation. And that's what I want to see happen this week with Vacation Bible School. And this next song, it's one of my favorites. Just in the bridge line, it says, I feel the tides are changing. I feel the walls are falling down. I feel the darkness is shaking, and we're calling up salvation now. And as we sing this song, I want it to be the prayer over this house that we're going to call up salvation for every single young person that walks through these doors this week, that they're going to enter into a relationship, that they're going to experience the greatest miracle of their lives, that their lives are going to be changed. They're going to be totally and completely changed by the power of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so as we sing this song, let's call it up. We're going to call up salvation now. Teach me how to listen. Oh, I want to know your voice. Show me how to wade through living in the natural to rise above the noise. Teach me how your heart beats. Oh, tether it to mine. The surgery is worth it to get below the surface and open up.
Kingdom come. Oh, I wanna see heaven.
not change. I feel the walls are falling. Person that's just going to be attending this week, call it up.
Down.
I feel the darkness shaking, church. If you listen to the news, it's all doom and gloom. But I'm telling you what, God can still work miracles. And He can change the tide in this culture. He can change the tide in this community. And He can tear the walls down. You know, one of the things I'm most proud of is, I think my wife said there's about 115 Vacation Bible School kids already signed up. You guys know that there's about 28 teenagers over here that are signed up to help out. I'm telling you, the tide is changing. There's a generation rising. The walls are falling down. That's the kind of God that I serve. Oh, Lord, we thank You this morning, and we call up salvation.
Thank you. great is our God, and all will see how great is our God, how great is our God, oh, how great is our God. Come sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great.
Thank you.
you believe that, put your hands together and give him praise. This morning, we're going to have about 200 kids for Vacation Bible School. Let me see the hands of everyone in here that knows the Lord. You were saved before you were 18 years old. Let me see your hands. Now look at that. Saved before you were 18 years old. That means that we have been given the greatest privilege any church could ever be given, to share the gospel with about 200 young people in this coming week. And it is the power of God that's going to change their lives. It's not a psychologist over at school. It's not a counselor somewhere, though I'm not knocking any of that. Only Jesus can change the heart. And that's what we're going to be praying for today, is a heart change. So we're going to pray up here. And those of you that are out there, I want you to notice that there are squares on the carpet. Everybody else that's not up here, I want you to find a square. And you go stand in one of those squares, and I want you to pray over every child that's going to stand in one of those squares. That's a soul that needs Jesus. So right now, all of you in here, go find someplace, one of those squares to pray in if you are not up here. We're going to pray for Judy. We're going to pray for Jackie's aunt. We're going to pray for Penny Hart, and we're going to pray for her brother Randy. Randy needs... He needs a touch. Thank you. He needs a touch of God this morning. I'm going to go get the anointing oil. Hang on just a second.
You're never going to let, never going to let me down. You're never going to let, never going to let me down.
All right,
down.
Go ahead and sing it.
You're never going to let, never.
Where's Chris at? Chris, come up here. Come and pray.
You're never gonna let me down.
how it is back there, but it's awful good up here. Shake hands with somebody. Hug their neck on the way back to your seats. All right, you can be seated for just a moment. We thought just in case that you weren't in the mood for Vacation Bible School, we thought that we could help you get in the mood just a little bit. And so I need... Well, for, here, let's do this. Ushers, come on up here. We'll do this psalm during the offerings, what we'll do. Bow your heads with me, and Tim, just pray over the offering.
How do you just pray over the offering?
Yes.
Pray over your people.
Yes.
It's good to see your people here, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
We're grateful. This is the way church grows from young to old. Jesus, assemble us in your holy name.
Yes.
We're a family in Jesus Christ.
Right.
We love with you.
Yes.
Till then, Lord, we will occupy, we will live for you, we will evangelize, we will lift up these children because they are not ours as much as they are your children. We put them in your hands, in your care, Lord God, because you are perfect and you are holy and you are righteous, and nothing escapes your righteous judgment, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, we're going to give you our tithes and our offerings. This is a small reflection of our love for you. This week, it belongs to you as does every week. What's new, Lord? There's nothing new under the sun. This is the day the Lord has made. We rejoice and be glad in it. Every day is yours, Lord. And you have given us that eternal day. You have given us eternal life. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the tithes and offerings that we can give back to you. In Jesus' precious holy name.
Amen. So, hey, hold on, guys. Before you receive the offering, I want to share with you real quickly here. The theme of this year's Vacation Bible School is Rocky Railroad. And by the way, didn't Alice do an unbelievable job on the backdrops? So, this year's competition, you're the first to find out about this. So, they shipped us directly from the Rocky Mountains. They shipped us a rattlesnake. And so this year, the loser of the boys versus girls competition has to kiss a rattlesnake. Now, how many of you in here, this is the year right here. How many of you want to see Jody have to kiss a rattlesnake? Man, that's not. So I hate to even ask this question then. How many of you want to see me kiss a rattlesnake? All right, all I can say is, guys, you better bring in the big money. Bring the checkbook. We'll have a swipe machine here for your credit card even. That's all I know. The money raised is going to go toward building that house over in the Philippines. Do you realize the past probably 5 years, every year we've raised over $1,000 with these kids to go toward various mission projects. If you want to bring in food, you can bring in food items, and we will get them to the food pantry over here in Amanda. We will get it restocked. So we've got a lot of great things going on. So I need all my young people up here, right, Jody? Everybody, young to old, younger to old, young to older. Come on, up here. Everybody up. We're going to do a song here. That's right. Come on, teens. We're going to get you ready for tonight. You want to? Yeah, better stay right there. You got to stand up. Yeah, I think I'm going to go around. Jody, I think I'm just going to figure out who my best one is here. All right, you guys can take up an offering while we're doing this, but you guys better be able to shout loud. Tim. You better crank it up there, too. Come this way. I want to see who can jump the highest. Give me the song. Crank it up.
He's the only one to put my feet on the ground. He's only one to turn my life around. He's only one I can call upon. Into his arms I'll always run.
Grace, grace, grace.
That's all that matters now.
Grace, grace, grace.
Guess they can't. the sound. Oh, how sweet the sound.
All right, the train's going to run off the tracks here. All right, I need, let me see, junior high and you're going to class or here? Junior high and high school are going to stay in here, and then preschool and the next class can be dismissed to head back to class. Everyone else is in here with me. Well, you're an awesome congregation this morning. Fantastic. Got the place packed out. I'm not going to be long this morning. And when I say that, I mean I'm not going to be long this morning. I'm not. They'll hold me accountable. You'll do what? There you go. You'll tie me to the tracks. I want to preach a message that I feel like, I don't know who this is for in here this morning, but I feel like this is for somebody in here today. I'm going to preach a message that I've entitled, Are You Living or Are You Just Existing? I could have entitled this Next Level Living. And I'm going to read two passages of Scripture, and then we are going to jump into this morning. First of all, we're going to read Galatians 2:20 and then John 10 and 10, two very, very, very familiar passages of Scripture. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ, but I live. Yet not I anymore, but Christ lives in me. And in that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who has loved me and given himself for me. And then John 10:10 says, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. And I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. Now, this has nothing to do with my message, but I want to throw this in here real quickly. I hear God gets blamed for everything. You know, why did God do this to me? Why did God do that to me? Why did God put me through this? And the truth of the matter is, it wasn't God that did it. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and life more abundantly. Steal, kill, and destroy is the devil. Life and life more abundantly is God. Amen? How many remember? No, don't raise your hand, because when I ask you this and you don't remember, then I'm going to be disappointed. About 5 or 10 years ago, I preached a series of messages that I called The Christian Atheist. And of course, we know that that's an oxymoron, right? A Christian atheist is defined, or I defined, a Christian atheist is somebody who acknowledges God with their lips, but lives as though he doesn't exist. I think I'm going to revive that series here in the next few weeks. I'm going to revive it, revise it, and preach it again. But I wanted to mention that in order to say, how many of you, when you got saved, you remember there was a growing and there was a maturing process that begins at an altar when you invite Jesus into your heart and you make him the Lord of your life. But we will never totally be like Christ until we go to be with Christ. The Christian walk is a journey. But having said that, 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And I know that, you know, I know people say, well, you can't judge somebody's salvation. And I understand that, you know, it's going to be just them and God when you stand before the great white throne judgment. I understand that. But if anyone is in Christ, he becomes a new creation, and the old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. What I'm trying to say is, if there is no change, you didn't get saved. You hear me? If there is no change, then you did not really get saved. I can tell you this. When I got saved, the way I thought changed. The way I talked changed. The way I acted changed. The places I went changed. The people I hung out with changed. The things I did changed. Now, there was plenty of room for Christian growth in my life. And the fact is, there still is. I've got a ways to go. But when you come to Christ, things will change. And there will be a discernible difference. If people can't tell that you changed, or people can't tell a difference in your life, then something's wrong. I told you years ago I had a friend I hadn't seen in a long time. Well, no, it wasn't even really a friend. It was an acquaintance. And he and his wife stopped in for service. And so I asked him afterwards. I talked to him. I said, you know, what in the world's going on? I haven't seen you since school. And what's going on in your life? And he said, I saw your name, Pastor Chris Hildenbrand, Frontline Church of God. He said, I didn't believe it. He said, I just had to stop and come in and make sure it was true. There's a difference. When you get saved, there is something that happens. There's something that takes place in your life. And the reason, here's the message. The reason for that difference is a little Greek word called zoe. Now, there are three or four words in the Bible that are translated into English as life. But zoe does not mean natural life. You and I are alive today, naturally. When we are born, we become alive. But that's not Zoe. Zoe is not natural life. Zoe is God life. Or more accurately, Zoe is the life of God. It's what we call eternal life. And Zoe's what Adam and Eve had in the garden when they walked and talked with God. And Zoe is what Adam and Eve lost when they sinned against God. Subsequently, every human being born after Adam and Eve were separated from God and were born without the life of God. We were living but not alive. Does that make sense? We were fleshly alive, but we were not spiritually alive because we lost that Zoe. And let me just go ahead and give you the gospel while we are here. God was so grieved because he created you and I for an eternal relationship with him. So he sent his only begotten son, his sinless son, Jesus Christ, to take our place on the cross and to pay the price that we should have paid and to die the death that you and I should have died. And he defeated death, hell, and the grave when he rose again the third day. And that's why Paul was able to say, and we just read it, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I that live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God. The word in there is Zoe. I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but it is Christ that lives in me. What he is saying is, when I was crucified with Christ, the life of God came to live on the inside of me, and I now have eternal life. Now I am living. Now I'm really alive. It's no longer I that live, but it's Christ that lives in me, Zoe. Christ lives in me. I have the life of God living in me. I have eternal life. And if God is living in you, things will change. You cannot have the life of God. You cannot have God living on the inside of you and things not change. We become a new creation. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new. Now, when I mention change, 99% of you in here, your mind goes to behavioral change. We think change in behaviors. And it is that. There will be behavioral changes. But it is so much more than that. When the life of God comes to live in you, when you've got the God life, it's more than behaviors that change. go to the mall, which I've only been there 3 or 4 times in my life, but go to the mall. Sit down, find a bench to sit down, and just observe people. Go to the grocery store. Observe people. One time, Larry, I was shopping for Christmas presents. Anybody ever go shopping during Christmas season? Man, they run down. They don't walk down the aisles. They run down the aisles. They got weapons with them called shopping carts. Man, I've been going down the, you know, I was walking down the aisle the one time I went shopping, and they were chasing me. They were after me. They were chasing. Get out of the way! Observe people. Their face will tell you everything that you need to know. They're stressed out. Their credit card is probably maxed out. Their bodies are worn out. Their hearts are crying out. Their peace has been wiped out. Their joy has been stomped out. And everybody seems ready to flip out. And I'm just talking about the Christians right now. Jesus said that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but that Jesus came that we may have life, Zoe. We're not talking about living, we're talking about Zoe. He came that we might have life, and the life of God more abundantly. He didn't just say that you might have life. He said that you might have life more abundantly. Do you know what the word abundantly means? It means above ordinary. Then, Chris, that means that as Christians, we don't just live an ordinary life, but if we've got the life of God in us, we live an extraordinary life. It's not just ordinary. It's extraordinary. Do you understand? God lives on the inside of me. My life is no longer ordinary. My life is extraordinary. God lives in me. It's not just life. It's an abundant life. We are not, as Christians, we shouldn't be just trying to get by or trying to survive. We live an extraordinary life. The word abundant also means overflowing. Somebody in here, where would I find that word overflowing in the Bible? Does anybody know? Where? How about Psalms 23? Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup, what? My cup overflows. That's abundance. Not just a little bit in there, not just to the top of the cup, but the abundant life. The more abundant life is, my cup is overflowing. Do you know that it's okay in life if your cup is overflowing. We don't just have to get by in life. We don't just try to survive in life, but our cup can be overflowing. Abundant means to abound exceedingly or excessively. Can anybody give me a verse in the Bible where I might find the word exceedingly? How about God does exceedingly abundantly above all that we could even ask or think? Did anybody in here hear that? God does exceedingly abundantly above all that we could even ask or think. So I want to ask you the question again. Are you surviving or are you thriving in life? Now again, when I talk about an abundant life, 99.9% of you are going to think in terms of an abundance of stuff or an abundance of money. That's how we've been conditioned to think. Abundance means an abundance of stuff. Or an abundance of money. And if we have an abundance of stuff, and we have an abundance of money, and we got a nice house to live in and a nice car to drive, do you know what that's defined as in America? That's called the good life. But the good life and a God life are not the same thing. And I know that probably even Christians spend more time in the valley than they do on the mountaintop, but that doesn't mean that we cannot enjoy an abundant life. I listen to Christians tell me all the time, Pastor, it is so hard to serve the Lord. You don't know how hard it is to serve God. I got saved and man, life is tough. Everything I try to do for God just backfires. Life is so hard. And then I hear things like, now that I'm not saved, it is so hard. I got to fight the devil every day. Life is hard. Got to fight the devil. Got to battle temptation. Man. Life is hard. You listen to most people talk, who in the world would want to be a Christian? Because it's so hard. And I'm not making light of anybody that goes through something in life. I understand that. We all go through things in life. But when someone tells me how hard the Christian life is, Kelly, I got a scripture for them. It's found in the book of Proverbs. I think it's chapter 13. Is that right? Chapter 13, verse 15. Ooh, good. It says, the way of the transgressor is hard. You think it's hard being a Christian. The Bible says it's the sinner that has it hard. You think life is so rough serving God. The Bible says it's the sinner that has it rough. It's the sinner in life that life is so hard for. And I'm going to tell you why. It has nothing to do with money, has nothing to do with goods, has nothing to do with stuff. Because Jesus said, I came that you may have life and life more abundantly. We're talking about Zoe. You've got the God, you've got God on the inside of you. You've got the God life on the inside of you. The reason that life is so hard for sinners is because they don't have the answers to life's toughest questions. Who am I living for? What am I living for? What am I supposed to do with my life? Those are the real questions that everybody is seeking the answer to. It's hard. That's why we as Christians, we live the abundant life. Because I know who lives on the inside of me. And I know who I am living for. Life is not about me. I'm no longer trying to fill that empty hole in my heart with things that only leave me more empty. The reason it's so hard for the transgressor, because they go out on a Friday night and they're trying to fill that empty space in their heart, and they grab a 12-pack of alcohol and they try to fill that space that only God can fill, and it only leaves them more empty. They go out and they go party and they shoot up drugs trying to fill that hole in their heart that only God can fill, and it only leaves them more empty. They run up to Scioto Downs on a weekend and they gamble trying to get a thrill to fill that empty space in their heart, and it only leaves them more empty. I could go on and on and on with things that we do, whether it be sex, whether it be girls, whether it be guys, trying to fill that empty place in our heart, and it only leaves us more empty. I'm telling you, that is hard. That's hard. I know who I'm living for. I know who I serve. I know what I'm living for. I know what I'm supposed to do. I know why I'm alive. I have a purpose in life. And my purpose is what motivates me to get out of bed every morning. I love God. And I love others. And I serve God by serving others. My life has meaning. My life counts for something. My life is not empty. I'm not looking for anything. I'm fulfilled in life. I've got Him. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd. One translation says, I got everything I need. I know who I serve. I know what I'm supposed to, be doing. I've got a purpose in life. How many people that do not know Jesus are wandering around lost, wondering, what am I here for? What am I supposed to be doing with my life? Does my life count? Would anyone even care if I was no longer alive? They ask those questions all the time. That's hard. And as a Christian, I'm not only told what to do, but God didn't leave it there. He told us how to do it. How many of you have ever went to the store and bought something, big project, come home and you either ignored the instructions or maybe the instructions were missing and you do what? And you spend the next 8 hours trying to figure out how to put that thing together. Anybody ever been there, done that? That's what life is without Christ. See, you and I have an instruction manual. We not only know who we serve, we not only know what we're supposed to be doing, but we have an instruction manual that tells us how to do it. No one else has that. They're going through life trying to figure it out. This is why life is so hard. They're trying to figure it out by experimenting. They're trying to figure it out on their own. They have no instruction manual. They have no idea. That's hard, church. That's why the way of the transgressor is so hard. Our life isn't hard. Yeah, we go through things in life, but I still know who I'm serving. I still know what I'm supposed to be doing. And I still know how to go about doing it. And Keith, the Lord will help me through. He always gets me through it. Always gets me through it. But the way of the transgressor is hard because he's trying it on his own. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I'm talking to somebody. One day, we will experience eternal life. But we have eternal life now. There is a difference between being alive and living. You hear me? You can be alive, but that doesn't mean you're living. I want to live. I want to live, church. Matthew chapter 6, verse 19. I want to read this to you. Don't store up treasures here on earth. Because what's going to happen to them? Moths eat them. Rust destroys them. Thieves break in and steal those treasures. I have the life of God living in me. That life is eternal life. And it cannot be stolen. And it will never deteriorate. And while the rest of the world is headed for hell, we can experience heaven. And while the rest of the world cries for help, we can experience healing. And while the rest of the world wanders around lost, we know the way home. And while the rest of the world is perplexed, we can experience peace. And while the rest of the world is hopeless, our confidence is in Christ. And while the rest of the world keeps looking down, you and I, we keep looking up. And while the rest of the world is sad, we are satisfied. Because I know in whom I serve, I know what I'm supposed to be doing, and I know how to do it. I have the instruction manual. How about you? Are you just living Let me put it another way. Are you really living? Are you really living, or are you just existing, going through the motions? You can have life, and you can have it more abundantly, because it's Christ that lives in me, Zoe, the God life. I have the God life. Would you stand to your feet? Did I do good? I didn't mean a sermon, I meant time. I meant time. Okay. Yes. Absolutely. We're going to pray. Bow your heads with me. Jody, how old were you when you got saved? 5 years old. How many of you in here, is there anybody else got saved before the age of 12? Oh, man. See, and you know what? They got, I'm telling you, what they got was real. That's what I'm saying. God came to live in them. Doesn't mean life goes perfect, but my, I would not trade what I've got for anything in this world. All those hands went up. God, this week, is going to come to live in the hearts of those young people. How privileged we are to be used of God. Where's Jesse at? Jesse, come here real quick. Here, no, she was sharing with me the other night. She said, can we put stuff on the walls? I said, well, of course we put stuff on the walls. She said, but it's going to tear the paint off. I said, how many times do you think we've repainted this building? But what about this? What about the stains on the carpet? What about, Jesse, it doesn't matter if one child, if the life of God comes to live in the heart of a child, I'll paint the building 100 times. Right? Jesus changes it all. You want to finish this out for me? No. This is the best life there is. And this life, it's only going to get a million billion times better. But I've got eternal life today. I've got eternal life right now. Their life is so rough. I get beat up every day, man. Oh, yeah, I know we get slapped around every once in a while. I know that. Not denying that. But boy, compared to what they're going through out there in the world, right? That's hard. Because they ain't got anybody to get them through it. that's hard. You get the point? Heavenly Father, Lord, I know you gave me this specifically, this message. And so, Lord, I can only believe that you are speaking to somebody here today to let them know it's okay, that life in Christ is so much better than anything else the world has to offer. And Lord, I just pray right now, every heart would be opened to Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're here today and you've not invited Jesus Christ into your heart, let me put it another way. If you want the God life, if you want the God life, you can have it today. All you got to do is say yes to Jesus. Tell him, I want the God life. Come into my heart. Be the Lord of my life. I think we've forgotten that Jesus really does come to live on the inside of us. Heaven comes into here, right? The kingdom of heaven's here. Anyone want to throw their hand up and say, Pastor, pray for me today. I want what you were talking about today. I want the God life. Is there one? Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Anyone else? I want the God life. If you raise your hand, come, let me pray. Let us pray with you today. Please. Just come on. There are going to be people that are just going to run right in behind you. I want the young people you gather right in behind these. And I want you to, in your own words, I want you to talk to the Lord. Just tell God, I am so sorry. I am so sorry. Forgive me of my sins. I want a brand new life. I want God to come live in me. I want you to tell him. Anyone else out there, you want to come pray this morning? Anyone else? Come on. We're going to wait for you. We're going to wait. God, come into my heart, into my life. Thank you. Others, come on, there we go. Come on, come on, come on, come on. We're going to pray. Others, you want to come? Find a place to pray right at the altar here. Kneel right here, and we're going to pray. I want the life of God to come in me. All right. No spectators. Come on, give me some people around here to, more people to fill the altar, and let's pray.
Inside my sails, the anchor in the waves, oh, yes, my soul. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days, oh, yes, my soul. You are good, good. out of where I hide. The ransom for my life, oh, is my song. And you are good, you're good. Oh, and you are good, so good. Oh, and you are good, you're good. Oh, and you are good, good. Oh, and you are good, good. Never gonna let me down, and you're never gonna let, never gonna let me down, and you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
Sing it, people.
And you're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
Hang out for just a moment. I'm waiting. Something I've neglected for about a month now. Maybe. people find this. How many of you are glad that you know the Lord Jesus Christ? You know, let me go one step further this morning. You know what the Bible says? That you are not just conquerors, that you are more than conquerors through Him that loves us. It's not just abundant, it's more abundant. Great job. Thank you. So, what I have here, and I need you to take care of this for me today. I have been praying specifically for young families with young kids. And Jody, what age is the most we got for Bible school? What are we filled with?
Oh, we have 32 preschoolers.
32 preschoolers. I pray specifically for this age group. What I have here, we need, we've got to fire our nursery back up again. And I'm not asking one person to do it all. I've got a sign-up sheet for one Sunday a month. That's all that I am asking for. So how many of you would raise your hand right now and just take one of these sheets and read over it and fill it out, and we just need to get our nursery taken care of, and we're really going to need it after vacation Bible school. So anyway, here, Josiah, raise your hand right now if you're willing to. There you go. Look at the hands that are raised all over this. Keep them up or go tackle Josiah and get one. All right. While we are doing that, what time do you need your crew leaders here tonight? 5 o'clock, all you crew leaders. We need you here at 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock doesn't mean 5:30. It means 5 o'clock. We need you here. Hold your nursery schedule.